Hadirin di Now You Know Cafe, Udemy Chapter, di auditorium Binus at Alam Sutra. Welcome ladies and gentlemen on Now You Know Cafe, Udemy Cafe, Udemy Chapter at auditorium at Alam Sutra. Okay. Pada hari ini kita kedatangan dua pembicara kita dari Udemy. Welcome to Mr. Oliver Simpson as Senior Marketing Development Manager for Middle East and Asia, and Mr. Giri Soehardi, MBA, as Head of Indonesia Marketing. Now I tell you about the speaker profile. Okay. Oliver is in the charge of developing Udemy in the Middle East Asia region. His responsibility including analyze the marketing environment, deciding on the strategic direction, providing intelligence for internal stakeholder, influencing the roadmap of other teams, and leading market manager of respective country. Giri is currently working as head of Indonesia marketing at Udemy. He is responsibility to lead Udemy developing in Indonesia. Prior to it, Giri served as country manager Indonesia for CIMA. Giri has experience working as financial analyst in banking industry and business development in ACCA, as well as marketing in a advertising company in London, UK. Please come Mr. Oliver and Mr. Giri to the stage.
Good morning, good afternoon. It's a great honor for me to speak here at Binus. I know it's a very innovative university. So my name is Olivier. I work for Udemy. I'm based in San Francisco, the headquarters of Udemy. I'm not American, I'm French. I'm born in France. And I moved to San Francisco a few years ago to join Udemy and to help them originally to develop the French market. And a few months ago, I changed position to help other markets, and Indonesia is one of them. So I'm working with Giri here. He's gonna speak to you later. Not in English, sorry again. I'm still learning, I only speak English and French. And so today I wanted to show you a few slides about what's Udemy and what we think the future of education is. But again, I think you at Binus, you are the lucky ones because you are still ahead of a lot of other universities in the world. Did you know about Udemy?
Yes.
Who knows about Udemy? Who has been on Udemy and took a course on Udemy? A very few, okay. So hopefully after you know more about Udemy. So you all know the world we're living in is changing very, very fast, very rapidly, and it's all about technology, right? It's this is this study. It's actually from 3 years ago, but we were saying in 2020. At that time, it seems a long time. It's actually already next year. But by 2020, 2/3 of the population on Earth is going to be online and have access to internet. It's already happening. More than 50 billion smart devices will be available for people to then access all these content. AR, VR, like these all new technologies are going to be available. It's going to change the way we learn, the way we walk, the way we teach. It's a big revolution, and you guys are part of it. So it's all about automation and technology. It's not only transforming the way we learn, so also transforming the workplace, like how people work on an everyday job. And those changes is different technology. Of course, the mobile internet, the cloud, it's the main driver of it. But also we talk a lot about big data, how the data is everywhere, how much data we generate every day, every second, anyway. And again, you're in the technology field, so you know all about this technology, and you're going to be part of this revolution. And what's scary is we know that the small kids, for example, I have two kids, they are 5 and 7. We don't know what kind of jobs they're going to have when they grow up. So how can we prepare them for their future, for their life, if we don't know what kind of job they're going to have? So learning is going to be very important for them, and also be able to adapt to that changing world. The youth employment, it's pretty big. So we want to make sure young people get the right skills so they can find a job and they can enter the job market, which is changing around. So we need to make sure people learn the right skills at the right time to get the right job for the way they can. And it's a world issue. It's not only in the US, it's not only in Europe, it's everywhere. There is what we call a skill gap. Is what we learn at school today, and what the can you hear me? And everywhere in the world, we know there is a skill gap, so we want to make sure that what you learn is going to be what the company needs for you to know and to help them to grow. The good news is people are investing in their learnings, part of our opportunity that to make sure everybody in the world can access the knowledge and can learn, so they can keep on going forward with the job. And the good thing for Udemy, people tend to learn more and more online because it's easier now with mobile, with the computer, anywhere, anytime, you can learn on any topic. And we'll talk more about Udemy specifically and how we can help for this. The thing is, the classroom has not changed. This might not apply to business because you guys have been very innovative. I've been talking just before. Everything like the blended learning is around here for kind of 10 years already, which is not the case in many other universities. So again, I think you're pretty lucky here. But overall, we know like the way of teaching haven't changed. Like technology have disrupted a lot of industries, not the education yet completely. So that's something we're actually working on. And at Udemy, we believe that the best teacher cannot always be found in a classroom. Again, that's not always true, but at least we want to give opportunity for the best teacher anywhere they are to be able to teach if they are anywhere from Bali to the south of Spain or in Thailand, anywhere, they should be able to share their knowledge and so be able to teach anywhere they are. And we think it's the right time. The technology is here, access to internet is here, it's pretty cheap. Everybody has a smartphone. Who has a smartphone here in the room? Like everybody, right? Looking when I arrived here, I saw everybody with a phone. So we can already all access the content. We all access Facebook, YouTube. So we're ready to learn on any device. That's a nice quote from Albert Einstein. Like learning is an experience, and everything else is just information. I think it's really about how we can today learn all the different kind of content. And at Udemy, we have three main beliefs. We think that by accessing education, education can really empower lives and change lives all over the world. And also the world best students are not always in the classroom, and we want to make the knowledge education available anywhere. Again, in Indonesia, for example, we think it's a huge country with a lot of people. Not everybody can come to Venus. It's either they're very far away. Like, how can they? Can you guys share your knowledge with anybody? With Udemy, you can do that because you just need a phone and a connection. And again, the best teacher should be anywhere and should be able to share their knowledge from anywhere. So that's, again, Udemy is the big mission to make sure we connect the best teacher in the world with the students anywhere they are. I'm just repeating myself here, but it's really, we are mission driven, and we really believe that we can change the world by doing that and helping people. And so Udemy, for people who don't know about it, it's a marketplace. That means anybody can teach, anybody can learn. And today we have over 100,000 courses available on the platform. So any topic you want to learn about, you probably find it. And even for a given topic, we probably have more than 10 courses. So you can even find the right teacher for you to learn on this given topic. We have over 42,000 teachers. So I'm sure there is one for you and one you would like to learn from. It's also available in 50 languages. So, of course, most of it is still in English, but it's geared to make sure we have more content in Indonesian, actually. Your university published more than 80 courses, so you can access the content from your university already from Udemy. On the other side, we have 30 million users that connect to Udemy to learn about all those topics. That's growing very fast anywhere in the world. 2/3 of our students are outside of the US. So more and more people from Indonesia, from Middle East, from Russia, anywhere in the world connect to the platform because people want to learn. And there is so many new skills they need to learn about. The good thing with Udemy is that we add new content. We talked about it before, but the technology is changing every day. There is new technologies, there is new way to work with technology. So we need new content to make sure you guys can about this new software, new data software, anything. We're adding more than 3,000 courses every month. So I'm sure if you don't find a course for you today, you might find it tomorrow, next week, or next month. And as we are a marketplace, our teacher can add content whenever a new technology is launched. So for example, if we talk about iOS, our teacher who are developer are teaching about developing apps on iOS, they make the course available even before iOS is launched to the public. So Apple launched the beta version for developers, and then developer can try it and learn about it, and then they create content. So whenever the iOS is available for the public for you to download on your phone and to update your phone, we already have courses for you to learn about how to make apps. And that's only on Udemy you can find this, because we have so many instructors that are passionate about creating content. They're always on top of things for any topics. It was the same for Bitcoin, for example. We had our first course in April 2013, a long time before it became mainstream. And so our job at Udemy is to match this content, all these new topics, with the demand of our users. When people search on Udemy, when they consume content, then we can recommend the right course for them. You're probably familiar with Netflix, but if you watch movies on Netflix, you watch 1, 2, 3 movies, then the engine would recommend you the movies you like, you would like, because the algorithm would help you for that. we have some kind of algorithm for learning. So if and you're learning about data science, we're gonna recommend you the right course for you to take next. The other thing we use it to be the marketplace, we have so many users, they take a course and they review it, and they will tell us, they will tell the instructor, and they will tell future students how good or how bad the course was. So they would review it, give it 1 star or 5 stars, and come in and say, yeah, I like this course because the instructor is very good, or it's very bad, or this is what I liked about this course. And that's the way we're gonna also help the other users to find the right course. So whenever you look for a course for Python, for example, you might find like 20, 25, 50 different courses, and so you're gonna look at reviews and see what people prefer the most in the different courses. That's also the way we help people to find the right content. And back to the matching algorithm, we know that people who start to learn on Python, they might be interested in deep learning, in machine learning, in R, in all those different topics, and that's how we're gonna help you to not only learn about one topic, but then go to the next one and keep learning and getting better at what you want to do. So again, this is this flying wheels between students and instructors, and about the right topic to the right people from the right instructors, and making sure we always be relevant for you to learn the next topic. And so what we want is to share this with the most of people. So we try to promote Udemy, we try to promote the knowledge on different platforms. So you might see advertising on your Facebook feed, on Twitter, on YouTube, or instructors promote their course, they post blog posts, anywhere you could find, you could try to find the content of Udemy. We also support our students and our users. So we have a big team of people. If you try to connect to Udemy and you have any issue, you can send an email to Udemy and someone's gonna answer and help you to make sure you can keep learning. And this is our instructors. They're really passionate people, they're expert in their field, and again, they're passionate about sharing the knowledge. They might not be a teacher in universities, they might be just expert in their field and just working as professional, but again, they're passionate about sharing their expertise. So that's about it, but we think that e-learning can really change life and help people to engage more with what they want to learn about. We see more and more people coming to the platform, learning about new topics, and increasing the learning engagement. And I wanted to show you a story about one of our students. His name is Mohammed. He's from Syria. He now lives in Germany. And at first he wanted to be a guitar player, a professional guitar player. And then he said, okay, maybe it's good for my friend to play guitar, but maybe I can't find a job, so I need to find something. But he'd never been to universities. So a friend of his in Germany showed him about Udemy, and then he started to learn Python. And I think it's a great story because he found a job because thanks to Udemy. I don't know if the...
I never had an idea that I would ever be uttering the words "I am a refugee in Germany." That sounds, yeah. I would never thought of that. My name is Mohammed Alanush. I'm from Syria, Aleppo. I live now in Berlin since already 6 years. Aleppo, where I come from, is the third group I'm sitting at. It's just that I didn't fit there. I felt like I really didn't fit there. I decided to pursue music professionally. A professor that encouraged me to come to Berlin and pursue music in Berlin dedicated his life to teaching. He just planned things right at the beginning. So you really feel that curiosity is his first goal. It was definitely the first time where I saw how much impact an instructor can have on a student.
I got the visa, I immediately flew to Berlin on the same day. But I didn't really realize that I actually gone to Berlin, Germany, Europe. It's like, you know, I'm just leaving.
So it was pretty intense when I left, because I've never left Syria without my family ever. I arrived with my clothes, big bag, and my guitar. Nothing else. I couldn't even speak the language. So the war in Syria took off a year after I came to Berlin. Some shooting started in Aleppo, and Aleppo is such a big, important city that nobody expected this to come so fast. Seriously dangerous for a young man to be there. So I had to apply as a refugee in Germany. And at that point, you kind of know, okay, you can never step a foot in that country. It was a sudden moment where you have to depend on yourself, whether you like it or not. That was when I realized I need something other than music that can really support a family. I was in the train and I met a guy who was a Syrian. And he was a software engineer.
He sent me a link to Udemy. And it was Python Masterclass by Kim Buchalka, the teacher, the best teacher.
And back then I always thought of programming, software, everything about IT is boring. Makes no sense. I definitely thought it was the most boring thing you could possibly do. But at some point, I just bought it for the sake of it. And day one, I got hooked.
For me, I did not know that.
And then by the second day when I realized, okay, this is a really cool thing to do, I sold one of my classical guitars, got all the courses, a lot of books. I think it was about a week when I knew I would be software engineer. 2 months after finishing my first course, I applied for many companies. One invited me. Right after the interview, I went back home knowing that I would not sleep for a week until I get the answer. But then they called me 1 hour after I got home and they said, yeah, it's a definite yes, everybody liked you, you did a great job. And they said it, I ran a bit outside and I'm like, I'm a software engineer now, that's crazy. Where I work now, we have 800 people and I'm the only one, I think, without a degree. After studying on Udemy, I have now a full-time job as a software engineer at a very exciting company. And I make 3 times more money every month than the money I spent on the courses on Udemy, which is a bit crazy. I don't know, I have this compulsive need to start writing teachers back. It's hard to believe that they don't know you, but they have such an effect on your life. I wanted to write letters. John Thompson, Tim Buchalka, Ardit Saltz, Diro Manduluru, Polash, Polsa, Chad, Derby, Jose. To every teacher who ever taught me anything, especially to Udemy instructors, thank you very much. I kind of feel a connection to you because I've heard your voice like a couple of hundreds of hours. Thank you so much for all of your work. Thank you for what you do. And please keep doing it. It really feels like that you care about the information you provide. You really care. Thank you so much for caring.
That's a very inspiring story for us, and we have so many stories like this around the world of people, because of Udemy or because of our instructor, they found on Udemy they could learn a new skills, and they would find a job or change their career. There's one thing I didn't mention here, but say we used to think like we go to school and then when school stops, we start a job and then we stop learning. That's probably not going to be the case anymore. We're going to need to keep learning all our life because everything is changing so much, especially in technology, like this is your field, if I understand correctly. And if you start learning just after school, in 2 years, 5 years times, you're gonna be obsessed and you're gonna need to learn everything. You're probably gonna keep learning all your life. And again, this is more stories about some of our instructors and people who teach on Udemy. And I wanted to also introduce you to a few of them.
I am Alexa Fisher. I teach confidence, communication, and how to get lit up about life with my 1,000-watt presence programs.
My name is Shani Raja, and I teach people how to write with the style and flair of some of the world's best journalists.
My name is Lazaro J. Diaz, and I teach Cisco courses.
I left my job as an editor for the Wall Street Journal, and I am now able to just do this full time, which means that I have a lot of flexibility in the way I work, and I can just focus on delivering really top quality education for people who I think would benefit from the skills that I've learned during my 20 odd years as a journalist.
The fact that I can reach students across the world and I'm actually doing and changing people's lives, that's what's the most attractive part of it.
I have been with Udemy almost since the very beginning, since 2011. And I love the idea that you can take what you know and help people that you will likely never meet. And there's something special about Udemy in particular, and I believe it was started with this idea that you can empower people through education. And on the flip side, you get to empower instructors to deliver what they love to deliver to people all over the world.
So thank you, and hope now you know more about Udemy. You're probably going to know even more with Giri, he's going to tell you about Indonesia. And thank you.
Thank you, Olivia. So, I hope you know my I will be speaking in Indonesian language. Okay, selamat siang. Okay. Ini kayaknya sudah pada makan siang belum ya? Belum ya, makanya agak lemes ya. Oke, jadi tapi nggak apa-apa. Semoga nutrisi pengetahuan ini bisa mengisi perut teman-teman ya. Jadi kita ganti nutrisi makanan dengan nutrisi pengetahuan pada hari ini. Jadi perkenalkan, saya Giri Suhardi, saya Head of Indonesia Market dan untuk Udemy atau Market Manager untuk Udemy. Jadi sedikit menjelaskan mengenai Udemy. Tadi yang pernah pakai Udemy boleh angkat tangan. Oke, okay. Yang pernah pakai online learning platform lain selain Udemy? Tapi pasti pakai online learning platform dari Binus kan? Iya kan? Oke. Okay. Jadi sudah pernah pakai semua ya? Oke, okay, jadi menegaskan dari Olivier, jadi Udemy adalah leading global marketplace untuk belajar online. Berdiri tahun 2010 di San Francisco, di US. Jadi misinya adalah bagaimana kami meningkatkan kualitas hidup melalui pembelajaran. Jadi manfaat yang dirasakan tidak hanya untuk orang yang belajar, tetapi juga orang yang mengajar. Jadi baik itu untuk student maupun untuk instructor. Jadi kalau teman-teman pernah masuk ke Udemy, itu kami ada 15 kategori orang untuk belajar. Dari mulai development, business, IT, sampai dengan misalnya test preparation. Jadi cukup luas. Dan kami juga berkolaborasi dengan Binus. Jadi per hari ini ada sekitar 80 kursus ya Pak? 84 kursus Binus di Udemy dan sudah 50.000 students yang enroll di Udemy. Jadi tepuk tangan untuk Binus. Dan kedepannya kami berharap kolaborasinya akan semakin banyak. Jadi bagaimana kami kita bersama bisa memberikan manfaat yang lebih besar untuk bangsa ini. Jadi ini kalau teman-teman masuk ke dalam website Udemy misalnya, ini ada kategorinya, kemudian ada subkategori yang bisa dipilih. Jadi cukup beragam. Saya ambil beberapa contoh misalnya kursus yang ada di Udemy, misalnya seperti menulis PHP, tapi bukan pemberi harapan palsu ya. Jadi ini untuk development, kemudian ada kalau orang misalnya pengen belajar entrepreneurship, saya pengen tahu tips-tips apa sih yang biasanya bisa saya peroleh dari belajar entrepreneurship, itu juga ada. Atau misalnya yang pengen karirnya cepat, karirnya tinggi, melesat, dia bisa coba beli khusus misalnya mengenai karir hacking. Atau misalnya mau Facebook Ads. Atau ada yang tahu Marie Kondo? Marie Kondo. Oh, ini untuk generasi tua aja kali yang suka Marie Kondo ya. Jadi beres-beres rumah, atau misalnya yang punya anak, misalnya bisa ikut beli kids yoga 101, atau misalnya yang sering sakit nih, ada kursus how to not get sick this year, bagaimana cara supaya tidak sakit. Atau kalau misalnya ada yang suka ke clubbing, ada yang suka ke clubbing, nggak apa-apa kok, nggak dinilai ya, ya apa nggak dinilai kan. Ada dance floor confidence, jadi bagaimana caranya untuk percaya diri ketika sedang clubbing. Jadi cukup beraneka ragam dan tidak hanya di browser, teman-teman juga bisa belajar dari perangkat yang berbeda. Jadi misalnya dari smartphone, dari tablet dan sebagainya. Jadi you can learn almost anything. Jadi ketika teman-teman sudah memperdalam knowledge base di universitas, ketika masuk ke dalam dunia kerja, ada beberapa skill yang ingin dipelajari, banyak pilihan sebenarnya untuk belajar hal tersebut. Kenapa online learning menjadi menarik saat ini? Saya akan jelaskan beberapa hal yang bisa melatar belakangi. Yang pasti yang pertama adalah teknologi. Teknologi mengubah sebuah itu. Mungkin saya akan tampilkan sebuah video yang pernah, mungkin ada yang pernah nonton video ini. Oke, jadi saya ambil contoh bagaimana teknologi itu sangat dekat dengan kita. Oops, ya kan? Jadi dari dulu misalnya tadi ada banyak benda di atas meja kita. Sekarang hanya tinggal laptop dan kacamata hitam misalnya dan smartphone. Bagaimana teknologi bisa membantu kita bahkan dalam kehidupan kita yang terdekat, misalnya selama ini kita mungkin mengalami kesusahan untuk memanggil mau pergi ke salon, sekarang kita punya aplikasi yang bisa memanggil tukang salon datang ke rumah misalnya. Teknologi begitu cepat mengubah kehidupan kita. Dan mobile video sekarang menjadi sesuatu yang menarik. Ini sebuah report dari Ericsson mengatakan bahwa mobile video traffic is the fastest growing category. Jadi semakin banyak orang yang menonton video, ya kan? Siapa yang setiap hari nonton YouTube? Banyak kan ya? Yang nggak nonton YouTube ini biasanya memiliki keterbatasan dalam pulsa mungkin ya, atau data kalian. Jadi kita bisa melihat rise of video. Misalnya di Facebook itu 10 juta, 100 juta jam video ditonton di Facebook setiap harinya di 2018. Twitter mereka juga ada pre-roll ads untuk video. Bahkan untuk Instagram, 6 dari 10 iklan Instagram itu sudah video. Jadi visual menjadi sesuatu yang menarik. Bagaimana membuat orang menjadi nyaman untuk memahami dari isi video tersebut. Dan yang kedua, kenapa online learning menjadi menarik? Karena millennials. Teman-teman semua millennials ya? Ada yang merasa bukan millennial nggak? Nggak ada sih, saya juga merasa millennial ya. Cuma millennial tua. Ya kan, millennial itu kan dari tahun 80 sampai tahun 90-an ya. Jadi sebuah report dari Udemy, kami bertanya ke para milenial bagaimana perasaan mereka tentang belajar. Mereka bilang bahwa 78% school mereka excellent dan good untuk preparing untuk kerja, dan mereka juga sangat haus untuk belajar. Ya kan, seperti kata Steve Jobs, stay hungry, stay foolish. Jadi ketika kami tanyakan bagaimana kamu memaintain atau meningkatkan skill kamu, milenial menjawab 46% ingin belajar melalui online. Ya kan, kemudian berikutnya adalah mereka ingin mengambil degree lainnya, baik itu misalnya mau mengambil S2 ataupun sertifikasi tertentu. Kemudian ada yang mengandalkan perusahaannya untuk memberikan peningkatan kualitas dan sebagainya. Jadi kita bisa lihat bagaimana orang milenial itu ingin belajar sendiri, karena mereka ingin punya otonomi, mereka ingin fleksibilitas dalam belajar, mereka ingin dihargai sebagai seorang karyawan misalnya. Dan yang ketiga, kenapa online learning menjadi menarik? Karena ada new skill to be learned. Tadi seperti Olivier bilang bahwa 65% anak-anak yang sekarang masuk SD akan berakhir pada pekerjaan yang saat ini belum eksis. Saya ambil contoh misalnya data science. Mungkin kita boleh lihat sekitar 8 tahun yang lalu ketika kita cari lowongan mengenai data science mungkin sedikit sekali. Sekarang kalau kita buka lowongan hampir setiap hari kita menemukan lowongan pekerjaan mengenai data science. Jadi perubahan begitu cepat. Kita juga bisa melihat bagaimana skill-skill yang dibutuhkan di tahun 2020 menurut World Economic Forum. Atau juga ada Udemy, kita melihat bahwa ada 6 skill yang growing cukup cepat di tahun 2019. Mungkin kayak beberapa tahun yang lalu kita gak pernah tahu AWS bakal menjadi sesuatu yang menarik. Sekarang termasuk suatu skill yang harus dipelajari dengan cepat. Ada tentang blockchain ya, currency digital. Kemudian ada Kubernetes, informatika, dan sebagainya. Jadi kita lihat bagaimana skill itu berubah dengan cepat. Ini sebuah kutipan dari McKinsey. Jadi di tahun 2030, jadi 14% dari global workforce, mereka harus switch ke digitization, automation, dan sebagainya. Jadi bagaimana teknologi juga mengajak untuk ini. Dan ketika kami melakukan survei, ke beberapa negara ditanyakan apakah AI atau automation akan mengganti pekerjaan kalian. Yap, jadi beberapa negara mengatakan hampir setengahnya bisa menggantikan pekerjaan kalian. Jadi begitu banyak ketakutan, dan kemudian bagaimana ketakutan ini bisa diatasi dengan skill-skill yang baru. Kita bisa lihat orang saat ini mau belajar skill baru dalam waktu yang cepat. Jadi kata kuncinya adalah cepat. Mereka nggak mau lagi belajar sesuatu tapi makan waktu yang cukup lama. Saya ambil contoh misalnya e-commerce, kita growing sekitar 30% setiap tahunnya. Ini mengubah sisi kehidupan kita, teknologi dan bisnis keep changing. Alhasil semua orang pengen belajar IT. Yang tidak punya background IT pengen belajar IT, pengen belajar programming misalnya. Yang sudah lulus dari program IT, mereka ingin akselerasi. Bahkan yang sudah punya pengalaman pun ingin tetap memiliki skill yang update. Jadi kita lihat bagaimana pengaruh misalnya e-commerce itu terhadap online learning sangat tinggi. Dan saya suka sebuah quotes dari Peter Drucker. Dia bilang bahwa satu-satunya keterampilan yang penting di abad 21 adalah keterampilan untuk mempelajari keterampilan baru. Jadi keterampilan untuk mempelajari keterampilan baru. Karena apa yang kita pelajari sekarang misalnya, mungkin 10 tahun lagi sudah tidak valid. Kita belajar misalnya Java 5 atau apa, mungkin 10 tahun lagi akan berubah. Jadi bagaimana kita harus membiasakan diri untuk memiliki keterampilan, untuk mempelajari keterampilan baru. Jadi ini sebuah revolusi, kita bisa belajar apapun, kapanpun, dan dimanapun, ya kan? Ketika kita lagi commute misalnya, naik kereta, ya kan kita bisa belajar apapun yang kita pilih. Udemy Indonesia sendiri aktif sejak Juli 2018, jadi memang kehadiran Udemy di Indonesia bagaimana kami ingin meningkatkan kualitas masyarakat Indonesia melalui belajar. So we would like to improve Indonesian lives through learning. Jadi kita bisa melihat banyak sekali tampil di koran-koran ataupun di media bagaimana isu tentang SDM di Indonesia. Bahkan salah satu dari IMD World Talent Ranking tentang competitiveness. Ada yang tahu Indonesia di urutan keberapa? Ya kan? Kita ada di urutan 45. Ya kan? Bahkan menurut Bank Dunia kita ada di peringkat 87. Bahkan dari media lain, Bos GE sebut SDM sebagai tantangan terbesar. Tantangan ekonomi digital, minim SDM, dan sebagainya. Kita punya beberapa riset yang mengatakan Indonesia akan menjadi negara besar di tahun 2030. Menjadi top 7, ya kan? Ada yang berkata, kita punya bonus demografi. Tapi ketika kita tidak membekali para generasi muda dengan pendidikan yang pas, dengan keterampilan yang pas, itu bisa jadi bukan bonus demografi, tapi boom demografi. Jadi bagaimana kita harus bisa membekali diri. Jadi ketika Udemy datang, kami ingin meningkatkan kualitas hidup itu dengan cara localizing. Jadi melakukan pelokalan terhadap beberapa fitur Udemy agar dapat memberikan manfaat untuk masyarakat Indonesia. Jadi tidak hanya untuk student, tapi juga untuk instruktur. Jadi kami melakukan pelokalan untuk bahasa. Jadi kalau misalnya teman-teman masuk ke udemy.com, itu websitenya sudah dalam bahasa Indonesia. Sebelum 2018 masih dalam bahasa Inggris. Kemudian tidak hanya dalam browser, tapi ketika teman-teman masuk ke dalam iPad misalnya ataupun dalam handphone, aplikasi itu juga dalam bahasa Indonesia. Jadi untuk masyarakat yang lebih nyaman belajar dalam bahasa Indonesia, mereka memiliki preferensi untuk belajar dalam bahasa Indonesia pada platform Udemy. dan juga local currency. Jadi sebelum 2019 semua mata uang dalam bentuk US dollar. Baru pada tahun 2019 kami memberikan dalam mata uang rupiah. Jadi kita sudah nggak lihat lagi, waduh, kalau saya beli sekarang nanti saya ditagih rupiahnya berapa ya kursnya? Kami sudah tetapkan misalnya satu kuliah 168.000. Jadi yang lain tidak akan berubah ketika dia membeli dan ketika dia ditagih. Dan juga kami menyediakan untuk payment method, local payment methods. Jadi selama ini hanya menyediakan dua pembayaran, metode pembayaran, kartu kredit dan PayPal. Tapi kami menambah karena kami menyadari bahwa masyarakat Indonesia memiliki kartu kredit cukup sedikit. Jadi bagaimana masyarakat diberikan akses yang lebih luas, mereka bisa membayar dengan misalnya melakukan transfer bank, kemudian ke Alfamart untuk melakukan pembayaran dan juga melalui GoWallet. Jadi kami ingin memberikan user experience yang penuh kepada masyarakat. Kemudian ada juga local marketing, jadi bagaimana kami mempromosikan kursus-kursus lokal. Dan juga yang penting adalah local content. Karena kami melihat kecenderungan orang Indonesia ketika mereka ingin belajar sesuatu, mereka lebih suka belajar dalam bahasa Indonesia. Jadi sudah semakin banyak orang yang membuat kursus di Udemy, termasuk Binus salah satunya, bagaimana bisa sharing. Jadi ketika misalnya saya memiliki keahlian tertentu, saya sharing misalnya bagaimana untuk membuat presentasi. Kemudian ketika ada orang lain yang ingin mencari bagaimana cara membuat presentasi yang akan match antara apa yang saya ajarkan dengan apa yang mencari orang. Jadi cukup banyak, dari mulai misalnya belajar gitar, menggambar manga, Premiere dan sebagainya. Dan juga yang terakhir, kami menyediakan local studio. Jadi kami menyadari banyak orang Indonesia yang ingin mengajar, tetapi mereka memiliki keterbatasan dalam recording. Jadi kami menyediakan studio untuk membantu students, instructor untuk membuat kursus. Jadi memang untuk menjadi Udemy itu, apakah saya harus bayar? Tidak, it's free. Kemudian copyright dari kursus pun tetap menjadi milik instruktur, dan nanti ada sistemnya pembagian keuntungan antara pengajar dan Udemy. Jadi for us it's about being inspired and being inspiring. Jadi bagaimana kita yang mau belajar, kita bisa being inspired, kita bisa belajar apapun. Ada suatu framework baru misalnya, atau suatu language baru kita ingin belajar, memungkinkan kita belajar dari ahli, orang yang sudah punya pengalaman di dunia kerja. Kemudian kita terinspirasi oleh mereka, kita bisa menjadi lebih baik. Tadi seperti disampaikan oleh Olivier, Muhammad dari Syria, dia datang dengan membawa gitar, berharap menjadi musisi, kemudian berakhir menjadi software engineer. Dan dia salah satu, dan dia satu-satunya di perusahaan dia yang bekerja yang tidak mempunyai bachelor degree. Dan juga it's about being inspiring, ya kan? Kita punya banyak teman-teman mungkin yang di luar Jawa misalnya, mereka ingin ikut kelas tapi mereka punya keterbatasan. Jadi dengan kita menjadi instruktur misalnya, kita bisa inspire mereka, kita bisa berbagi pengetahuan agar mereka bisa menjadi lebih baik. Oke, jadi mungkin kurang lebih itu presentasi singkat dari saya. Mungkin berikutnya kami serahkan kembali ke MC. Terima kasih. Oke, kita sampai di sesi tanya jawab. Oke. Okay. Sir, this is Mr. Richard. He is a vice president of Udemy in Indonesia. Okay. Kita balik ke tanya jawab dulu mungkin ya. Ada yang mau nanya dulu?
Hello everyone. We're very excited to be here at Binus University. As we're launching our community on effort here in Indonesia, we feel extremely privileged. Please, we start here at Binus University. It's already a great partner of us, 84 courses on Udemy. We hope that we continue to expand our relationship. Not only working with faculty, a student here has more content in Udemy, but also as our launching pad, ingress online learning, online education, live learning here in Indonesia. So we are excited to start our journey here at Binus.
Okay, kita langsung ke tanya jawab ya. Ada yang mau nanya dulu?
Mic-nya ada.
Okay, good morning, good afternoon, Mr. Richard and Mr. Oliver.
My name is Sharon. I'm from BINUS University, majoring in international business. And I want to ask you about, I think my question is not a formal question, but this is point of view some people. So, point of view some people around education. So, especially in Indonesia, I always hear that this statement saying, what do you learn in class is just a theory. Theory which taken from life experience. So that is useless for yourself. Why you need to sit down in your classroom to get that theory? Okay, thank you.
I'll be happy to share my thoughts. And I think it's still very useful to be a student at a university. There are actually many things come to university and sort of college to learn. If I think back what I gained from university, I think probably three things. One, I learned a lot of knowledge from faculties. It is true that technology change on a regular basis. What you learn today may or may not be directly relevant. From a trade perspective, from the work perspective, might be directly useful. I think you're building a lot of framework, the foundation, right? We talked about, for example, one of the things that are very, very important is you learn the skill to learn, right? I think you come to university building the foundation, building the critical thinking skill set, not gonna last and benefit for you for the life. Not necessarily a particular sort of, let's say you wanna be an electrician, that type of things, but the fundamental skill set are actually very, very important. That's number one. Number two, and the reason you are here, obviously, it's a great facility, a lot of faculty and help teach you. But I think all your classmates, they are smart. They come from different background, different culture, and I think you will learn from each other. And going forward, I think you will be all leaders in different aspects. It will be really good. You forge relationship after college for many years to come, and eventually when you go to work. That whether it's government, whether it's actually enterprise, whether it's a non-profit, whatever case might be, your classmates will be play a very important major role, and if you know of them, will be actually good for your career. I think number three, that this is, relatively speaking, it's a risk-free environment for you to learn, experiment, a lot of things. For example, if you work in a company, it'd be less actually risk-free because whatever you do, people look at your performance and everything else, but being a student, relatively speaking, it's risk-free, right? So you can experiment other things, you learn this and that, and lay the foundation for your career growth many years to come. So I still believe strongly that college education is very important. But that said, the question you raised is enough. I think that there are many other areas you can learn, enhance your learning experience in the college. For example, what we are talking about here, Udemy, provide a lot of interesting learning opportunity, spent from different candidates may or may not necessarily offered by the university, because a lot of, for example, cutting edge technology in the marketplace might be really interesting, relevant for you, whether it's internship or rather of college, to work for some company. Those type of things can be enhanced through online education platform like Udemy. So it's necessary, but perhaps not just all you need to do. So I hope this is helpful.
Thank you for Mr. Richard. Okay, another question. Okay.
Hi, my name is Dia. Yeah, Denny. So I'm a lecturer here. So my question as an academic is that how you actually can actually maintain the quality of the contents that you provide in Udemy, as well as I mean how you actually evaluate also the content and the lecturing. Also the process or the assessment systems that you are actually using in Udemy. Thank you.
Yeah. So we let the marketplace review the content and the quality. So Today we have 30 million users that enroll in process, and they give us a review, they give us their comments, they give feedback to the instructor, and so this is a kind of feedback loop to the instructor and then the quality of the content. So the scale and the volume of the enrollment and the content and the students make the quality in a sense.
So let me add in a few different colors. So if you think about how we control the quality or improve the quality, there are really three things. One is we're working with potential instructor before the published courses, how we actually make the course creation, the process easy, robust before publication, right? So that's one step. The second step, how we're working with instructor during the course creation, help them actually get better at course creation, high quality. So that's sort of thing two. Stage three is how we actually control and put a robust quality measure after the course published into the marketplace. I think Oliver mentioned quite a bit about the third, right? Once the course get published, how we're working with instructor, make sure they deliver the right content, not only the right content, but also engaging experience, right? So student will give comment for the instructor to see if this is rough, you know, it's a good course or not good course. So if you look at the ranking, that's give you a pretty high level around whether it's a good course or not good course. And also specific comments. So it's very colorful comment from students from different perspectives. And I think the other thing is probably easy to spot that is the other thing is very important. You look at how many actual students you know in a particular course. Right? Some of the top courses, for example, you might see 10,000, 200,000, in some cases actually 500,000, right? So if you've seen some of those numbers, the chances are they are pretty good courses, right? Because a lot of students from different parts of the world, they raise their hand, they spend their own money in taking those courses. The chances are pretty good. So let me briefly talk about the first and the second in an area I think that you probably can add more. So the first one, and we create robust process. We have 75 plus of steps for each instructor you have to go through creative courses. We have a lot of template, success case, and we even have a course on Udemy, how you create a course on Udemy, right? So help instructor read through the course creation. I apologize for the typical. So, for example, most instructors, they have very good content, they have very good curriculum, but how to translate into an online course? And we are here to help, right? So that's sort of, once they decided they actually want to create courses, along the way, we give the feedback. And normally, I think that every course submitted, probably there are two or three times, we provide feedback, they actually have to go back, refine. So it's a pretty robust process before publication, during publication, obviously even more so, sort of market-driven process, make sure high-quality course reads on the top. If the course is not good, when you search those courses, they are probably on page 5 or 6 like a Google search, right? Never being found. So most courses, when you try to look for, typically rise on the top are good quality courses.
Okay, enough. Thank you, Mr. Richard and Mr. Oliver. Now we have a question from webinar. Okay, wait a minute. Okay, in the middle. Dear sir, how many features are there in Udemy? And what are they? In the middle, in the block one, the feature, how many feature?
So, because like we couldn't really understand the questions like how many features, but we can say like we have like 30 million courses. We have 100,000 courses, and then we have in 30 million users, and it's in 7. We have 100,000 courses, so we don't really sure what the features means, but we'll go with the next questions. Where is it? Okay, can we go scroll up, please? Hi, I'm interested in Udemy Learning for digital marketing. Do you have some programs? Yes, we do. So basically, you can go on our search bar. You just put the keywords. You just put digital marketing, and then you can find some courses, a lot of courses for digital marketing. And then you can click on each course, and then you can see the curriculums. So for example, you're looking for some specific topic in digital marketing. You go click the web the course. You go to the curriculums. Even you can click the video course, video promotions, so you can see what the course focus on. So there's a lot of topics in digital marketing. Not only digital marketing, there's a lot of topics that you can explore.
And you're probably gonna find a lot of courses in English, but since 2 days ago, most of the top English courses have Indonesian caption, subtitle, so you can definitely learn from American experts on digital marketing. And if you're not too sure about your English, you're gonna find Indonesian subtitle to help you.
So let me actually add a couple points for the feature. I assume the question probably are more around learning experience. For example, what can you do when you take a courses, right? So just the course we working with instructor with a wide range of different topic, obviously, also a wide range of different lengths of courses. But normally, we break the course into what we call the bite-sized chunks, right? So we break, for example, 20 hours, maybe 100 hours, depends on the complexity of the topic, into 5 minutes, 7 minutes, 8 minute chunks. So between the chunks, between the session, what we call that, there are quizzes, there are questions. So to help you actually understand, make sure you understood the concept. In some cases, you may actually have to go through some exercises before you go to the next session. So that's a typical sort of user experience. But beyond that, we make the learning easy, wherever you are. For example, you may actually take the courses online at your desktop. You might prefer to do it actually on the mobile phone. So we make the course learning not only available on desktop, but on the mobile, better than that. So for example, you may taking course at the dormitory, and then on the way to classroom, you stop by, for example, cafe, and you could actually pick up where you left on your mobile device seamlessly. Then when you finish classes and perhaps finish some the project with your team, you go back to dorm, and you can actually pick up where you left on your mobile to your desktop. So there are actually a lot of those features built into the learning experience, and make sure you can learn wherever you want to learn and however you want to learn. So those are just some of the examples. Obviously, if question gets clarified more, we can provide more examples. But that's just high level. Some of those functionality features we're building to help support better learning experience.
And you can also download the course on your mobile. So if you're somewhere without Wi-Fi, or any sort of connection, you can still keep learning.
Okay, mungkin pertanyaan yang lain ya. Let me help translating. So does Udemy have a plan to help people who don't have access to internet but want to study? I mean, do you have plan how we can help people without access to internet?
Today you need at least at some point internet to at least download the app and the course. But again, if you go to the university with a Wi-Fi hotspot, then you can use it, get a course, download it, and then go back home. If you don't have internet, you can still study.
So I would add on this that we're not internet provider for sure, but on the other hand, what we're here is to provide wonderful learning opportunity. I think that whether it's industry or government entity, they must feel the need to provide a necessary means approach to provide the facilities so people can access online. So in the last few days, we had multiple conversations with a lot of ministry here in Indonesia. They are very, very keen, passionate about the talent developing in the next years to come for Indonesia. They feel very strongly to allocate resources and budget to support the online education. So we feel comfortable, confident that we are very much aligned with the policy going forward. So I think the infrastructure will get better, the learning opportunity will get better. So all those opportunities, whether it's online or offline, I think that we'll be working with the enterprise, government, to provide those interesting, useful learning opportunities for student population in general here in Indonesia.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Giri, Mr. Oliver, and Mr. Richard.